Welcome, welcome to the spooky, unlucky, for some reason, the number 13 is unlucky, I don't know why, podcast number 13 with your boy, Angelo. And in fact, let's look that up here, since, you know, what else am I doing here? Why is 13 unlucky? Let's see. Oh, is it lucky or unlucky? Interesting. So both why is 13 lucky and unlucky both came up. So who knows? Some believe this is unlucky, the number 13, because, oh, biblical, Judas Iscariot was the 13th disciple? What? Weird. Let me just see what's on the Wikipedia here. What a way to kick off the podcast, me already not knowing what the fuck I'm talking about. The number 13 is considered a unlucky number in some countries. The end of the Mayan's calendar, well, you know, they got a lot of shit wrong. But the end of the Mayan calendar's 13th baktun, I'm not sure what a baktun is, was superstitiously feared as a harbinger of the apocalyptic 2012 phenomenon. Oh, okay. Fear of the number 13 has a specifically recognized phobia. Triskaidekaphobia. Say that three times fast. Triskaidekaphobia, a word coined in 1911. The superstitious sufferers of triskaidekaphobia try to avoid bad luck by keeping away from anything numbered or labeled 13. What a weird phobia to have. As a result, companies and manufacturers use another way of numbering or labeling to avoid the number, which hotels and tall buildings being conspicuous examples of not using the 13th floor. But you know what? If you're on the 14th floor, you know what floor you're really on. It's also considered unlucky to have 13 guests at a table. Friday the 13th has been considered a unlucky day. Weird. And then there's a list of religious reasons why 13th is wrong, is unlucky. You know, I'm not going to go through all this, because then there's a lucky 13 in China, France, and Italy. So basically, no one knows what the fuck it is. For some reason, people are just drawn to the 13. So if you think 13 is lucky or unlucky, you're a dope. Moving on. In this podcast, what I wanted to do is basically clear out my diary here, because the last couple podcasts, I've wanted to do it, but then I get on tangents, or I talk about movies or politics, or I just get stoned and ramble. But speaking of, tonight I'm smoking a indica joint. I forget the name. I think it's from Fire Bros, a dank company. So if you got it with you, light it up like I will right about now. Ah, yes. About a nice joint in the evening. Because after this podcast, ladies and gents, I'm going to start a new book. Oh, that's right. Recap. Let me dab this mofo out here. Oh, what a fun podcast this is already. Already tons of awkward silence and me getting distracted. And I don't think we're even 5 minutes in yet. So, okay. I finished The Water Dancer. Good God, was it an amazing book. It was not as good of an ending as I hoped. However, I still give it, let's see, out of 10 decimals in play, I would give it probably an 8.5, 8.6. No, maybe an 8.4, somewhere around there. 6 is too high, 3 is too low, but it's in the 8s. So, in my opinion, the ending just kind of dragged, and they kept building up this final, it's either going to be a conflict, a resolution, or something. And although we got some kind of closure, we didn't get the kind of closure that I was expecting or that I was hoping for. So it's got to get a little bit of a ding there. However, it's still an amazing book. I've since found out it is a Oprah book. So if that means anything to you, then if Oprah says it's good, then read it. But you know what? Fuck Oprah. Your boy Angelo tells you to read it. And I'm smarter and better put together mentally than Oprah. Although, if someone says that, they probably are not. So, take that with a grain of salt. So, here we go. Let's dig into the diary. First thing, in my opinion, Sissy Spacek, the actress, in Carrie, is a hero. Now, I know that may be a little bit of a controversial remark there. However, I need to point out that in the movie Carrie, and I believe it was in 1976. Yep, here it is. The movie's only an hour and 38 minutes long. Damn. By the way, let's back up. First off, do you know the movie Carrie, and do you know who Sissy Spacek is? So, brief recap. Carrie is a Stephen King horror movie. It was directed by Brian De Palma. Brian De Palma has made some amazing and some pretty horrific movies. He's up and down, but this is one of his gems. Carrie tells a story about this really dorky high school girl. She's sheltered. She has a horrifically domineering religious mother who's just, if you look up evangelical cunt in the dictionary, there's a picture of her. By the way, who played her mom in this movie? Because she should have won an Oscar. Let's see, was it Piper Laurie? No. Maybe. I guess I should find out what her mother's name is. I don't know. It doesn't matter, people. So, she is just this very awkward, kind of like the worst case of homeschooled Amish, dorky, nerdy. Just, this poor girl has nothing going for her. And when you see Sissy Spacek, which she's just one of the best actresses. Okay. I hold Sissy Spacek in high regard. She's been in so many banging movies for so long. And Carrie is, I think this may have been her first movie, but it's got some of the most iconic scenes in cinema. Rarely does a horror movie get revered this much in the community, because for whatever reason, when I say community, I mean like critics community, you know. Who ranks the movies, the AFI, is it AFI? Top 100? I don't fucking know. Anyhow, horror movies don't get a lot of respect, is what I'm trying to say. And Carrie's one of the few exceptions. So anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. I'm thinking about the film community. This podcast is already a train wreck, but let's keep it going here. So, back to the movie. She has possibly the worst mother ever in cinema. She's getting teased. There is a cruel, cruel joke played on her. But little do they know that Carrie has superpowers. Nah, I'm not talking about good superpowers like the flight or telepathy or, you know, speed or shoots flames or shit out of her. No. I'm not going to give anything away, but she has a power. So, anyway, it takes a lot to play this role. And Sissy Spacek knocks it out of the park. And I hope she would have gotten, yep, nominated for 2 Oscars. Let's see. They better tell me one of them was Sissy Spacek, or I'm going to hurl this computer out the window. Yep. Yeah, okay, it was Piper Laurie. Did play her mom, because both Sissy Spacek and Piper Laurie both were nominated. One for Best Actress, Sissy, and Best Supporting Actress, Piper. But they both lost. Now, who the hell beat them out in 1977? Because that was an amazing performance by both. Let's see. Let's go to Best Actress. Faye Dunaway. Okay, Network. Sissy Spacek lost the Oscar in 1977 to Faye Dunaway for the movie Network. Now, normally, I would have lost my shit. However, Network is one of my all-time favorite movies. I own it on DVD. I watch it once a year. It's a genius film. I will go too crazy if I just will keep talking about it. You need to see the movie Network from 1976. It perfectly sums up what America was in the 70s and where it was going. Little did they know that they pretty much hit it out of the park with this bleak outlook on what the 80s and 90s and, well, fuck, the 2020s is in regards to television, the media, the ownership, the bureaucracy between the media and the money and the politics and durka. However, oh shit, Rocky came out that year too, because Talia Shire was nominated too. Damn, there's some dank movies. Carrie, Network, and Rocky all in the same year. Now, who beat her in? Oh, okay, for Network. Damn, Network cleaned up. I forgot. Oh shit, Taxi Driver was 1976 because Jodie Foster nominated. Fuck me. All the President's Men came out too. Logan's Run, bruh. What other movies came out? Okay, just listen to the Best Actor category. You got Network, Peter Finch, who won, which is, he deserved it. De Niro for Taxi Driver. Now, I know you're thinking, okay, Peter Finch may have been excellent in the movie Network, but he's not a cultural phenomenon that Robert De Niro was. And you know what? I'll give you that. I agree. But they didn't know that. If the fucking Oscar voters in 1977 could foresee 30 years down the road saying, holy shit, lonely white kids are still shaving their hair into mohawks and talking in the mirror like De Niro and Taxi Driver. You talking to me? Are you talking to me? Well, you must be talking to me because I'm the only one here. Ah, shirt gun. Network got nominated for two actors. William Holden. Yeah. Now, there's an Italian actor here named Giancarlo Giannini. Now, I've heard of him, but he got nominated for Seven Beauties. I don't know that one. And Stallone got nominated for Rocky. But what is the Seven Beauties here, this Italian film? The defense of honor, a strong value in Neapolitan society, and his effects on the love of everyone. Pasquale Frafuso. Oh, it's a war movie. I'm already getting depressed looking at it, but I'm getting sidetracked, people. The reason that Carrie... If you know the movie, then I'm sorry that I just have been wasting... Oh, geez, the last... how long has the podcast been recording? Anyhow, if you know what happened in the gymnasium, in my opinion, she was in the right. I think she was a hero. Those kids were assholes. Now, did the teacher deserve to go? No, she was trying to help the whole time. But you know what? Carrie's a... adolescent teenager full of all this raw emotion. There's gonna be unfortunate casualties. But then, man, when she locked him in that gymnasium and, she's a hero because she was killing the bad people. That's all I'm trying to say. She was wronged her whole life. Everybody that she did had it coming, besides the nice teacher. And you would think the poor bastard with the long hair that got hit in the head with the pig's blood bucket. Boy, if you haven't seen the movie, and I'm telling you, pig's blood bucket, you're thinking, what kind of fucking movie is this? It's an A-plus movie, that's what it is, jabroni. Anyhow, everyone deserved it. I always find it funny when Travolta and his girlfriend get it. Like, she just turns and the car flips and explodes. Amazing! Can you imagine if you had that power, if you had Carrie power? That'd be so cool. When I die... And if reincarnation is real, but I get to, like, tweak it a little bit, and I could be like, can I come back as the character Carrie? And they said, do you want to go back as a fictional female teenager that has psychokinetic? Is that her power? I don't want to spoil it. I already spoiled it, everybody. If you haven't seen the movie yet from the mid-70s, what's wrong with you? But yes, I'd like to go back in time as Carrie, and do it right. I'm not going to spoil the ending, but there definitely wasn't a sequel. I know by the way, side note, they did make kind of a sequel. I believe it came out in the 90s. It's kind of the same exact story, but it's like a new teenager Carrie. And, I'm too lazy to look it up. I don't know, it's a piece of shit movie. They tried doing the same thing. And then I think they remade it a couple of years ago with Chloe Moretz, Grace, and Julianne Moore. And in the trailer, I'm just like, boo, you can tell 10 seconds into a movie trailer that the movie's going to be bad. You're like, ooh. Whoever greenlit that movie needs to get fired immediately. So, Carrie was a hero. Sissy Spacek was great. I would put her in the top 5, I mean, top 10. I have to really think about that. Top 5, that's prestigious. Top 10 greatest performances in a horror movie. Because it's so much more than a horror movie. But anyhow, moving on. If the Star Spangled Banner were changed. So already this is a juicy one. Before I continue reading, let's honestly think about this. Should we change the Star Spangled Banner? It's a little old and not that catchy anymore. We need to update it. And what I would vote for, if we were voting, well, let's say we all came to the same conclusion. The Star Spangled Banner is old, it's not catchy, doesn't have a good chorus, and it's, like everything that this country is built on, it's just time for a change. Keep the history as a learning tool. Hey, you know what we used to hear all the time, and everyone pretended they loved it, especially on the 4th of July, is this, kind of average sounding, kind of just, dog shit song, Star Spangled Banner. And we kept it so long because of tradition, but, what's tradition except just pressure from old people? Well, that's what I think, anyway. Most traditions are just history from old people that just stress us out. Why? They're dead. Why should the worries or concerns of dead people concern us? Come on. Anyhow, what am I talking about? Oh, yeah. If I was changing the Star Spangled Banner to a new tune, I would choose one of the greatest American musicians, Bob Seger. And I know what you're thinking. Bob Seger, out of all the musicians to choose. And let me tell you why Bob Seger. Because listen to the song, You'll Accompany Me. And you tell me, straight-faced, and you really mean it, that you don't feel like standing up and covering your heart when you hear that song, especially when the chorus drops. I would play it, but I don't want to get sued or kicked off this wonderful service that I'm on. Fuck it. Oh, I mean, just the beginning. It just makes you feel like American Pie and driving a truck and having a golden retriever in the next to you. It's open country around you. You're going about 50. Open highway.
A gypsy wind is blowing warm tonight.
Oh, hell yeah, the sky's blue.
The sky is starlit and the time is right.
Hell yeah, Bob.
And still you're telling me you
probably a cool 77.
Before you leave this song,
your window's down. Half-lit cigarette in one hand.
Something you should know, babe.
Room temperature beer in the other. Steering with your knees.
I've seen you smiling in the summer sun. I've seen your long hair flying.
You popped a few pain pills before the ride.
I've made my mind up that it's meant to be.
Your good old boy dog's head's out the window, tongue flapping in the wind. Listen to this song, man. Tell me this isn't America. Oh, come on. Star Spangled Banner ain't nothing compared to this. Come on, man. You're telling me if you could choose between that and Star Spangled Banner, you would stick with the Star Spangled Banner? Are you out of your mind? But, you know, honestly, I would choose almost all Bob Seger songs over the Star Spangled Banner. And I would also choose, Night Moves would be a good song by him. Oh, man. I don't know. You know what you guys should do? If you agree with me and think the Star Spangled Banner is a bit dated and we need to update things, hit me up with your song choice. But I'm telling you, Bob Seger, You'll Accompany Me, you listen to that song, and if you don't salute the flag, then get out of my country. I had to pause things because I wanted to play that whole song because I just got so happy playing that little snippet. I just had to just groove a little bit. I had a little bit of dark chocolate coconut. It was amazing. But, you know, when I was dancing and I started to think, I do dance a lot. And maybe I should share this little tidbit with you all. What helps me, I think, stay somewhat positive, somewhat not, lonely or depressed during the quarantine times, because I understand, it gets lonely, you get bored, you get angry, depressed, you know, there's a lot of negative emotions flying around, and you're warranted to feel them, I would argue. I think it's completely understandable. You shouldn't blame yourself for feeling sad, but what helps me is that at least once or twice a day, I try to have a dance session by myself. Now, I usually do it at home, in the house. Sometimes, if I'm feeling good, I'll do it in the front yard where the neighbors are, and I'm checking the mail, maybe I'll dance a little bit or shimmy a little bit, you know. I mean, not insane. I mean, I'm not causing a scene, but, you know, I'm just grooving, you know. I'm dancing a little bit and get my heart rate up a little bit. Now, the reason I find that very positive is you're listening to music that you love. You're dancing, which, even if you say you don't like to dance, give it a try. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised. It cheers me up. You see very few people when they're dancing actually look like they're unhappy. Even the goth kids, when they're doing that unhappy kind of shuffle with their shoulders back and their head up, and they're kind of just, oh, nothing matters. You know what? They're having a good time. They're having a good time. So that's what I would recommend. Once a day, maybe you could do it to two songs. Sometimes if I play some dank dance songs, they could go up to 20 minutes because I like them long remixes. So just dance, man. Dance like nobody's watching. Who cares? You don't have to be good. You don't need to break a sweat. You don't need to have a stroke while doing it. Just dance. It's kind of fun. Just groove and move, baby, you know? And so earlier today, I danced to the song Another Life by Kano, K A K-A-N-O, Kano. They're an Italian disco group from the 80s. I think this song was in the mid-80s. So, Kano, Another Life. And one of my favorite songs, just in general, is by Vitalik. That's V-I-T-A-L-I-C, V, as in vajayjay. And the song is Poison Lips. I would recommend putting on the music video on the YouTube. And if you don't dance to that song, I pity you, and I'd like to talk to you. I'm not a psychiatrist, but I feel like I'm just as good. Talk to me. Nobody in a healthy frame of mind can listen to Vitalik's Poison Lips and watch the music video with the cowboys dancing, and you don't at least crack a smile. You don't at least stop worrying about your concerns for at least a couple seconds. I mean, come on. We're not robots yet, people. So, anyhow, that's what I would recommend doing. Once a day, just dance. Just dance. We should be staying more active in quarantine now, because now you don't have an excuse not to exercise or work out. But anyhow, it's just fun. And it puts a smile on your face. And some people, that's all you need is just one smile a day. Because if you can't make yourself laugh, if you can't enjoy yourself, I mean, what's the point of living? What's the point? You know, we only have one go around on this world. Well, to some. Some people believe you have multiple goings arounds, or there's something after this. I don't know. We don't know anything. All I'm saying is, all we know for sure is that we have now. So why spend it moping when you could be dancing? Alrighty then, back to the diary. The movie, some more movie stuff. So, the movie Starship Troopers is a masterpiece. Starship Troopers, you're fucking right it is. And, yeah, that's another movie that I would hope most of you have seen. It's been out for, I think, 20 years? Yeah, it came out in 1997. So, oh man, that's more than 20 years, 23 years, damn! Anyway, directed by Paul Verhoeven, Starship Troopers is a futuristic movie about us versus an alien species of giant insects. Humans in a fascist military future wage war with giant alien bugs. That's all you need to know, people. We live in a fascist military world. We love it. Everyone's a soldier. Even the children. Everything is equal, men and women, in the front lines. They shower together, they sleep together, there's no separation, nobody gives a fuck. Everybody's fucking and shooting and dying. God bless America, you know? Anyway, it's got Denise Richards in it, it's got Neil Patrick Harris is in it, Clancy Brown's in it, Jake Busey, and of course, the star is... Wait a minute, where's the, Michael Ironside, who's one of the best character actors and B-movie actors ever. In fact, I think he just recently passed. But you know what, I better make sure I'm not talking out of my ass here. He did die. Ah, son of a bitch, he's alive, I was wrong. But you know what, I'm glad you're alive, Michael Ironside. If you died, I'd be really upset. Who was I just talking about? Oh, Michael Ironside is money in the movie Scanners, by the way. Anyway, so they're directed by Paul Verhoeven. He did RoboCop. That's right. RoboCop is another masterpiece. Anyway, Starship Troopers, I know it bombed in its initial release. It's one of those movies just like The Big Lebowski. It bombed and it came out. Critics didn't like it. But over time, it just got an insane cult following. Now it's really hailed as way better than anyone thought it was when it came out. Because it perfectly sums up America's just lust of war. And sending off young people to go fight these hypothetical glorious battles. And a lot of people drew parallels to this movie to the Iraq War during W's term. Because the insects were a metaphor for the Middle East. And of course, all our soldiers is America. Anyway, if you haven't seen the movie, watch it. It's cool seeing Neil Patrick Harris trying to, like, not be Doogie Howser. Because he's still babyface in this. And this is before How I Met Your Mother. Pretty funny. Denise Richards is just god-awful in it. But, you know, she's eye candy. Everybody's eye candy in here, by the way. Every actor, maybe besides Busey, is very attractive, which gets you to another point. The star of this movie is called Casper Van Dien. You haven't heard of Casper Van Dien? I don't blame you. By the way, his character in Starship Troopers is the best, because he looks like a Aryan-looking white guy, and his name is Johnny Rico. Johnny Rico. How is that not like a Duke Nukem side character? But anyway, Casper Van Dien, I don't know what happened to him. Maybe Starship Troopers happened to him, and his career never was able to come back from it, but, I mean, he was really good. Oh, shit, he was in Alita? And Sleepy Hollow? And Tarzan? You know what? I apologize, Casper Van Dien. You have been in some stuff. And I give you credit. You've been in a lot of the Starship Troopers sequels that you probably shouldn't have been in because there's been way too many of them. Oh, yeah. He was in the Starship Troopers 3 Marauder in 08. Is there any more after the third one? I saw the second one. And that was a... Oh, my God. He was, and that was a pile. Oh, no, Casper. You're in a movie called Sharktopus versus Whalewolf. Whalewolf. Now, can we just pause a moment and talk about this movie? Sharktopus. So already you're combining two animals. Shark and an octopus. But you know what? They're both in the ocean. I'll give it a pass. Whale wolf. Huh? Whale wolf? A whale and a wolf? They should never be in the same room together. I'm pretty sure if you go to a zoo, they don't have the whales next to the wolves anyway. Now again, a shark and an octopus, yeah, they're in the same area. They live together. They're roommates. But a whale and a wolf? Do I dare click on... I feel like clicking on this movie is going to give my computer a virus. When a mad scientist mixes the genes of a killer whale and a wolf, it creates the whale wolf. they got the best whale. They got the best whale. If you were gonna make a whale wolf, you better get an orca. Because those things are brutal. They're like us in the ocean. They kill everything. They don't eat each other, but they eat other whales. They eat dolphins. They eat seals, penguins. They kill things. They don't even eat it. They kill great whites. They kill fucking hammerheads. They kill the big whales that are like triple their size. And they eat them. Sometimes they don't. Again, I don't think animals could be, quote-unquote, human characteristics, like evil. Because I don't think orcas are evil. You gotta do what you gotta do to survive. But to kill something for the sake of just killing it and then fucking with it. Because there's been a lot of video, at least what I've seen, of orcas, after they do kill a seal or a penguin or something, they'll just literally hit it out of their water with their tails like they're playing tennis. Just back and forth. And you're thinking, huh, what kind of evolutionary behavior is this? Are they training, like, a baby orca to know what to look for? And then you realize, oh, there is no baby orca. They're all, like, adult orcas. And then they don't even eat it. They just leave a carcass floating in the ocean. They kill it for no reason! So, they're assholes, but they're cool. I like orcas. Yeah, I know they killed a few people in, amusement park, SeaWorld, but that's what you get. That's what you get. I'm sorry, but that's what you get. You don't put intelligent animals in cages like that. Keep the dumb ones in. You never see a giraffe complaining about being in the zoo. Or, you know, what's another dumb animal that every zoo has? Oh, every zoo has, like, deer. And then there's, like, birds. And there's, like, a reptile thing. And they got hippos. You know, there's some standard animals that you're just like, yeah, they look like they don't know the difference. But if you put something smart in there, like an ape, or, yeah, a dolphin, a whale, then no wonder they start killing people, because they're too smart. They need to be in the wild. But you know what? I like seeing them in the zoo, because then I don't have to go in the wild. So, again, Angelo is a hypocrite. Anyway, moving on from Whale Wolf. Oh, by the way, to end this movie synopsis. So, this mad scientist creates Whale Wolf, and somehow I'm not sure who they is, someone who's fighting the mad scientist, possibly. It's up to them to free Sharktopus. So, okay, so they release Sharktopus to fight Whale Wolf. Whew, I mean, how do some movies get made? Here's your homework, people, when it comes to movies. Watch Carrie, watch Starship Troopers, and watch the trailer for Whale Wolf versus Sharktopus, what the fuck ever it's called. And something else I want to get off my chest. Chimpanzees are assholes. That's right, folks, you heard it here first. Chimpanzees are assholes. Just because they're intelligent doesn't mean they're not a bunch of hairy cunts. And let me tell you why. For the last couple nights, right before I go to bed, I start watching this Disney Plus nature series called Wild, and then fill in the blank. No, I was watching Wild Congo for the last couple nights. Three episodes, each one did a part on part of the apes. So the first episode was by the gorillas. Gorillas are cool. I love them. Who doesn't like gorillas? I feel bad for Harambe still. Second episode dealt with the chimpanzees. Now, the third episode dealt with bonobos, which are the complete polar opposite of chimpanzees. And let me tell you why. Chimpanzees, at least the Congo chimpanzees, are such assholes from like 5 years old, with the old male chimps on top, and then you get the younger ones at the bottom of the rung, and then you get the infants, basically up to teenagers. I think they're saying the equivalent of 15 years old. They are considered low class, because it's crazy. The chimpanzees have a caste system. They have a class system. And then all females are at the lowest rung as well. So I didn't know that. I thought it was fairly equal, with males probably dominating, but not this much. And yeah, basically they were showing the chimpanzees just beat up the female chimps, beat up the infants, beat up the teenagers. They're always, the older chimps are always starting shit. And they get violent, man. They can fuck up another chimp, especially a younger one. And, you know, chimps are hunting monkeys, which is crazy because they're basically hunting their cousin. But, you know what? I can understand. I got cousins, you know. I mean, it's so crazy to think that they are our closest biological relative in the animal kingdom. And they are one of the most violent animals on the planet. Violent. Like, they have wars with other chimp groups, like, with weapons and shit. Look it up. It's crazy. No, and I didn't get stoned and watch Planet of the Apes, which I have, but this is not where I'm getting the information. They haven't learned to shoot a gun or ride a horse yet. But, you know what? I take that back. I think there's been video evidence of chimps riding horses, but maybe it was in a circus or something. But anyway, I mean, they're just assholes. And so I was like really rethinking how I thought of chimpanzees, because I've been souring on them lately because, you know, you heard, remember that story a couple of years ago about that chimp that like was a pet or something and it ripped off a woman's face, and it was horrific, but you're also thinking, maybe we shouldn't have an ape as a pet, you know? Imagine if humans were pets by like a slightly more evolved species. Like, they're still humanoids, but maybe they're like 20 feet tall and like different colors, at like purple and green and blue, and they just treat us like we, like the way we treat chimps, like have them in leashes, putting them in movies as a gag, and, you know, test drugs on them and stuff. But so yeah, I rip off their faces too. So, but then more information kept coming out. Like, I saw a chimp war thing online, and that was messed up. I'll never watch that again, seeing what they do to one another. For some reason, they always rip off the cock and balls, and then they rip out like fingers, and like they really make it torturous. Like, it's awful. And like I said, they hunt all things that they eat. It doesn't matter what it is, they'll eat it. Which, again, I don't blame them. They're animals, but they're fucking assholes to one another, man. Let me see here. Chimps riding. Okay, the first one said a bicycle. Chimp riding horse. Okay, but let's see. Is this in the wild? I don't know if horses and chimps are even in the same, like, habitat. Okay, considering all the images that are coming up are from, like, movies from Planet of the Apes, or, like, obviously are CGI, I could be wrong. Maybe a chimpanzee has not been caught on film riding a horse in the wild. Can you imagine how horrifying that would be? You're just going on a hike or something, and you just hear this noise, and you hear the hooves of a horse, and you're like, why is there a horse? And you turn around, and there's a fucking chimp riding the fucking horse going, ow, ow, and then just like, I mean, you'd be dead. You'd be dead before your brain could register what you were seeing. Anyway, back to the show. Chimps are assholes. That is what I learned. Now, the third episode dealt with the bonobos. Now, the bonobos, in case y'all don't know, are technically the closest biological evolutionary relative we have. They're just, to my understanding, they're a chimpanzee, but slightly different. So they're like a cousin of the chimp, and that being that further removed from the chimp and closer to us. Anyway, they basically look like chimps, but they're slightly smaller, not as strong looking, and they're not as rough looking, if that makes any sense. Like, if you see chimps in the wild, they are fucked up looking. They look like pirates. Like, they're all leather faced, and their eye, like, they always got cuts and gashes and bites and, like, fingers or toes missing, or, like, you just tell that they've lived a hard, swashbuckling life, and, you know, fucking eye patches. Okay, that would be something else horrifying if you see a chimp with an eye patch in the wild. You're like, how did he learn to make it? Anyway, so, now, I knew a little bit about bonobos, so I'm like, alright, I know they're not as violent as chimps. They're the polar opposite of chimps, which is crazy because both of these creatures live in the Congo, and they're separated by, now, albeit a very wide river, so they will never meet. They can't swim, which is something else I learned. I did not know that besides the orangutans, no apes can swim naturally. And so bonobos, instead of dealing with everyday life with violence first, as the chimpanzees do, they deal with love first. And when I mean love, I mean they all fuck one another. And that's how they resolve disputes. Every gender fucks every other gender. It doesn't matter. And, like, they didn't say what age it starts happening, but they're saying, like, it's pretty young. So, male on male, female on female, and everything in between. It's crazy. And they also, like, do it for, like, goods and services, the equivalent of. And so, it was crazy because they were showing these bonobos in their little troop, and one of them started fucking around, and one of them, like, was fucking with, like, the prince. Because, oh, that's another big difference. The bonobos are entirely female-run. That was another big difference. So instead of being male-dominated like the chimps, bonobos are female-controlled, and the males live with, you know, everyone lives together. But the males are much more docile because they're probably getting fucked all the time. I mean, it looked like every hour on the hour, it was just a fucking orgy straight out of Eyes Wide Shut. But you know what? They all look brand new, right? Fresh out of the packaging. There was no cuts or bruises or missing limbs or, you know, scars or anything like that. And even when that one bonobo was messing with the prince, because yes, there's the head female, the queen, I suppose, and she has a male son, and there's the prince, and there was a nurse bonobo, the equivalent of a nurse, was just fucking with the prince, and it was going on for a while, and the queen was just like watching it, and you know, the narrator's like, oh, she's judging if the prince will stand up to them. I'm like, okay, do we really know that? Do we really know that? Are we putting human characteristics on animals again? You know, maybe they just didn't give a fuck. Who knows? Anyway, so the queen had enough, chased the other one, and they ended up fucking. And the TV show did a damn good comparison. They were saying if the chimpanzees are like the warriors, the soldiers, then the bonobos are the hippies. And they each control their own little world. They both have the same large area to kind of harvest and control, and they don't have natural predators really, because they can fuck up basically anything. By the way, bonobos also eat monkeys and kill things and eat meat as well, so it's not like that's different. They're hippies, but they still like monkey meat. You know, a lot of things eat monkeys. I wonder if monkey meat is good. I mean, they eat it in a lot of countries, but we're getting off topic here. So yeah, so chimps are assholes. We should be trying to be more like bonobos, is my point. All right, let's close this one up. In closing, I want to say if I would ever join a cult, it would probably be if Kevin Parker created it. Now, for those of you that don't know who Kevin Parker is, you got to get your life together. You're slipping. He goes by the stage name Tame Impala, who very well might be the best musician of the past 10 years. Yes, I said it. And if you don't know his music, just type in Tame Impala, check it out. To describe it would be an insult to his brilliance, but I'll do my best. He's basically Australian Jesus, who has the voice of all the angels put together, and he combines psychedelic pop with psychedelic rock. Here's why I would join a cult if he ever started one. His lyrics are always on point. They're very thought-provoking. They're very quick and to the point. He gets a lot of emotions across very succinctly, and I've seen him on interviews, and I never disagree with anything he says. He already looks like Jesus. I think it would be very easy for me to join this. If I looked on, if I found out that Tame Impala has started a cult or started a religion, within 5 seconds, I'd be looking that shit up. All right, well, what are we talking about here? I'm sure it would be full of peace and love and kindness and respect. I mean, do yourself a favor. Listen to Lonerism. That was probably his most accessible one. But then, if you like that, check out Currents and the Slow Rush. Oh, Currents! And Slow Rush. Slow Rush is a little depressing. It's a little depressing. But that does not lessen its brilliance. So, yes, if Tame Impala, Kevin Parker, starts a cult, if you ever hear this, Kevin, I will be your deputy. I will do anything you want. Anything! Well, you'll be, you know what? Yes, even that. Oh, Christ. All right. And lastly, let me say I want to give props to this chocolate shop that I went into in the outlet mall in the Auburn Super Mall. It's called Gosanko, Gosanko. I went in there a little bit stoned, and I just wanted a coffee and some chocolates, and, you know, I paid for it, and I said, I'll be right back. And they said, oh, you're not going to take it now? And I said, no, I don't want to walk around with a mask and a hot coffee in a mall, you know, just, you know, I want to be in and out, you know. And so when I came back, about 20 minutes later, coffee was still warm, still looking good. And this girl working there boxed it all up nice and neat. Made it look professional. What I'm trying to say is that when I came back, they gave me additional chocolate, additional what I paid for. So I paid for 5 pieces, and they gave me like 10. And they just said, thanks for your business. Because, you know, they're a struggling business. So that's my point. My point is, try to support small businesses. Try to go, you know, if you can afford it. I know a lot of us are on budgets right now, so I don't look down on you if you have to do what you got to do to survive. Of course not. However, if you do have a little bit more cash on the side, and you're still going to big superstores like the Targets, the Walmarts, the Amazons, just, you know, think twice. Maybe look up a family-owned market that still is going to have the same shit. Are you going to pay more? Probably. But like I said, you got money to spend. Try to support that. Because if we don't support our community, our local businesses, then all we're going to have left is just giant conglomerations. I mean, think Wall-E style, all right? Think Blade Runner style. I mean, like, you would have, like, one company own almost everything, and then you would have like 3 or 4 other smaller companies that are still massive. Is that really what you want, people? No. So come on, support small businesses, especially now. Anyway, man, oh man, right when I am almost done with this podcast, I see that Joe Biden picked his VP, and it's not really a shocker, Kamala Harris. My opinion is, it's no big deal. She doesn't hurt him, she doesn't help him. She's from California. I hate to break it to you, Dems, but you were already going to win that state. She's not really a progressive. She aligns more with the moderates, of course. That kind of makes sense why Biden picked her. She doesn't have the best record as the Attorney General. She did some good things, but some bad things look real bad. So I give it a C. Who the fuck am I, right? But, yeah, no big deal. I would have had maybe Tulsi Gabbard on there. I was a big fan of hers. I also would have maybe picked Stacey Abrams. I would have been okay with, but these are just my picks anyway. And I also would have picked Nina Turner, who helped run Bernie Sanders' 2016 campaign, but I'm a little biased because I tend to go progressive, but that's just my opinion on this whole Kamala Harris, Joe Biden thing. It's a big old whiff. Anyway, I love you, jabronis. Have a good rest of your night, and take it easy. Something you should know, babe. I've seen you smiling in the summer sun. I've seen your long hair flying when you run. God bless America. I've made my mind up that it's meant to be. God bless our soldiers. God bless Jesus. God bless bald eagles. For some reason, that's the American animal. Out of all the animals to choose.